Hello everyone, my name is Primadiva, and welcome back to this series, where I try to create a cohesive and believable ecosystem out of the Kanto region. So far there have been 4 episodes, and they're all pretty much connected with each other, so go check those out before diving into this one. Last time I covered the awesome fiery canids of the Kanto region, and how they all interacted with each other in unique ways. To contrast that, today I'm going to cover a very special type of felid that appears in the Kanto region. You might not think it does, but it does. I'm of course talking about the Luxray line. This Pokemon line is actually extremely common in the region. Now, you might be thinking, wait a second, Prima, those only appear if you use the radio to specifically lure Sinnoh Pokemon, so that must mean that they are migrating, right? Well, yes, that is a possibility, but another possibility is that they're just living here. I say this because you can also do the same with Hoenn Pokemon, which I find very hard to believe, because as far as we know, Hoenn is very much disconnected from Kanto, Johto, and Sinnoh. You know, those three regions, they seem like they're at least on the same country, or land, or continent, or whatever, but Hoenn is very far away. Plus, we know it's an island, so I can't see a Pokemon like, I don't know, Poochyena, for example. I can't just see that randomly teleporting to Kanto just because it hears some Hoenn sounds. Although that might mean that the Hoenn region is actually closer than we originally thought, and that they are indeed just migrating, but I personally like the idea way more that they're just living in the Kanto region, although both ideas could definitely work. It's just that good old ludonarrative dissonance at it again, not really giving us an explanation, so we just have to make one. Although a Pokemon like Chatot might possibly just be migrating, I mean, birds are known to migrate. Big felids, yeah, not so much. But anyway, let's cover the Luxray line. At first glance, you might just assume that these Pokemon are like lions, right? Well, I'd say that they're more like lynxes instead. So they'll be in small groups and hunting a variety of prey. Ironically, this line is found less in Sinnoh, which makes me think that maybe they're just not doing so good there, and decided to move to Kanto, perhaps through trainers or on their own. Shinx is very cute, and I'm sure that most of us caught this absolute baby very early on in our Sinnoh adventures. And like a baby, this Pokemon likely stays with its mother for a while before being able to hunt on its own. That makes sense, because if it's in danger, it will light up and glow to blind its enemies, until others, like its mother, save the little kitty. Size-wise, it probably can't hunt a lot on its own, but it can fry smaller Pokemon, especially birds who are weak to its electricity, like Pidgey and Spearow, so it can just easily get some KFC if it wants. The need for hunting on its own isn't that high though, considering it lives in a small group, likely made of family members. After evolving into a Luxio, it's now able to hunt successfully, being able to have others famed from even a small scratch. That's pretty brutal, but this scratch just happens to be filled with, of course, a lot of electricity. A cool thing about these Pokemon is that they can help each other deliver more powerful attacks by joining their tails together. Isn't that cute? So if something is bigger than them, they have an easier time just frying it. So they're like regular lynxes, just more social, and can shoot electricity. They also communicate through cuddling, basically. They rest their forelegs on others, and they use rhythmic electric pulses from their claws to communicate. Aw, that's just so adorable. Luxray, however, is much bigger than your regular lynx, so it's almost like a lynx that's a lion, and that's, of course, super dope. These probably act as leaders for the group, spotting prey for the rest, and then the rest of them going after it together. An amazing ability this Pokemon has is being able to see others behind objects, probably through seeing their electrical signals. This is extremely handy for spotting prey, danger, and its own kind. As a side effect though, it needs to sleep some time after using it, so the rest of the pack will have to be careful while it's sleeping. Other than that, I mean, you just upgrade Luxio. Make it bigger, give it even more electricity, give it stronger fangs which they can perhaps shock prey with. That's just super cool to imagine, honestly. And also make their claws a lot stronger. And well, you got Luxray basically. Regarding their groups, I think it's mainly a matriarch. And that females stay, but males leave as they grow up. This makes sense because one of their abilities is rivalry, or maybe it is like lions, where there's one male to father all the cubs, and males get thrown out once they're grown. Unlike what you might assume, female lions actually do most of the work in the pride. Because of their electric typing, for some reason I can see them doing best by just zapping bird Pokemon out of the sky, or just anything really. But still, imagine a group of them just absolutely roasting a Pharaoh. That just sounds super cool. Sure, the fiery canids can do this as well, but it's just not super effective on flying types. That actually makes me wonder if they would also be good at hunting water-type Pokemon, although I can't imagine them being around water a lot, because most cats, well, they just don't dig water. About that water, there's actually a Sinnoh line that is just as common as the Luxray line, and every route is in, there's actually water. Wow, great move there, Game Freak. Say welcome back to the Bibarra line, everyone. It's just as common as it was in Sinnoh. Wait, no? Oh, it's actually more common in Kanto. Well, what the heck's going on in Sinnoh? Bidoof was also a Pokemon I'd mostly catch. When it evolves into Bibarel, it's a great HM user. But also, these two Pokemon, they just look super cute. They look friendly and nice. As a result of their abundance, I can easily assume that, just like beavers in real life, they're a keystone species. What this means is that these Pokemon play a very critical role in the ecosystem, due to their effect on the natural environment. So if it wasn't there anymore, things would go wrong for a lot of Pokemon that have already adapted to this changed nature. And the effect they have on nature is, well, clearly the dams they build, which these Pokemon are known for throughout the regions. What this dam does, like with beavers, is to provide the Pokemon with protection from predators. It also provides lots of food, so that's extra helpful during the scarce times of winter. As seen in Pokemon Mystery Dungeon, Explorers of Sky, in the episode Bidoof's Wish, these Pokemon were shown to be social and live together with their families. They're already confirmed to live in small groups, but families were never specifically stated. But like beavers, I'm sure that's also the case with these Pokemon. So a mama and papa Bibarel, who love each other very much, can have as many as around to 3 to 4 Bidoofs at a time, and their social group can be as big as 10. I can't imagine Bidoof specifically eating other things. I mean, they live in groups, so they would all just eat from the same things, like tree bark and various vegetation. Like the Raticate line, they need to constantly gnaw on things so that their teeth don't become too long. Stronger than an actual beaver, which of course, I mean they're Pokemon, even as a Bidoof, these Pokemon can chew down boulders. And if you have teeth like that, I mean that's a great defense against predators, so don't try to mess with those chompers. Bidoof likely eventually leave the nest, probably as soon as they evolve into Bibarel. With beaver kits, as they're called, this can take from 1 to 3 years, so let's assume that the same goes for Bidoof. Bibarel is also apparently used to protect cities and other places, as a dam built by a Bibarel will never fail, making it one of the many Pokemon that humans use for work. These Pokemon are also a lot faster than they look, well, at least in the water, so don't go messing with their dams. Their revenge could be swift. To be honest, they're just the Pokemon version of beavers. But that's also important to know, because we know now that dams really shape the ecosystem in which they're in. Unlike beavers though, they do seem to inhabit some salt water, but it's still mostly fresh water. Unlike beavers, they do seem to inhabit some salt water, but it's still mostly fresh water. But of course, in those waters lay many other Pokemon, such as, well, you'll have to wait until the next episode. Tell me, what did you think of this episode? How do you feel about all these Sinnoh Pokemon slowly invading Kanto? Let me know your thoughts and opinions in the comment section down below. As always, if you enjoyed this video, be sure to hit that like button and subscribe if you haven't already. I got lots of cool stuff on the channel and always more coming soon. In case you're feeling generous, I have a Patreon which is in the description down below. It's only $1 a month and it really helps me with this channel. And with that being said, I hope y'all have a good day, night or morning, and as always, take care.